Thank you, John. You've moved us again. Well, good morning. Welcome to worship here at Christ Memorial Church. Whether you're here in person or watching online, we're glad you're with us. I have to tell you something this morning. When I began to interview for this job, there was one part of the description that I knew I couldn't do, and that was pastoral care, because I live 35 miles away in Northeast Grand Rapids. And so I was afraid there would be no care for all of you wonderful people. Then I began to explore the staff and discovered this wonderful care team behind me. I don't know if you know who they are or what they do, but they're here this morning to lead us into worship and to introduce themselves to you so that you know that God cares for you through them. Melissa?
Thank you, thank you, Pastor Stan. Good morning, Christ Memorial. It's an honor to be up here with our Care and Connections team this morning to call us to worship. It's also a privilege to be a part of such a humble and amazing team. There's been so much happening under Care and Connections here, even in our times, our challenging times, our transitional time. Just last week alone, our Care and Connections team had 128 contacts ranging from phone calls, visits, emails, text. We had three facility communion services in the last month, a meet and greet at a couple of our facilities by the care team. So the care is going on. I would like to briefly introduce each of our team members. Myself, I am the faith community nurse and also the coordinator of care. Part of my role is visiting and making contacts with each of you, but also overseeing the health and the wellness of the church in a few different ways. We have a medical first responder that sits on Sunday mornings. We have a dementia caregiver support group, oversee the AEDs, medical equipment closet, just to name a few. Next, we have Pastor Carol and Pastor Norma, two very caring and compassionate pastors of visitation. They have spent countless hours visiting, calling, bringing communion to the homebound. They also bring communion to some of our local facilities, and we have one this afternoon at Appledorn North and South. They visit in the hospital, they visit in homes, and they also spend some time officiating funerals as they come up. So this just names a small portion of what they do, but I am so grateful for both of them. One individual not present this morning is Doris Van Kooten. She is on a little vacation, but I want to acknowledge her too. She is such a priceless person. She serves as administrative assistant. She helps us track all the details and organizes the care that comes into the department. And she also sends out an email to a couple hundred of you with prayer requests each week. Next is Terry Vanderlee. He's up here on behalf of the Care and Connections Elder Board. He's our current chair of that Elder Board, and his strong and dedicated leadership helps to assist the board in oversight of membership, care, prayer, and sacraments such as communion and baptism. I also want to acknowledge a lot of our volunteers who aren't formal staff, but also we have 50-plus care partners that call on some of our homebound saints, bringing visits, calls, flowers, taking them on outings, and serving them communion. So we are blessed to have each of them. We also have C2 Care and Connections volunteers that serve on a care and repair team. We have memorial funeral servers, medical first responders, greeting teams, bus drivers, transportation volunteers, etc. I would like to welcome, if you have any questions or would like to talk about any of this further, to our care kiosk that we have in the mixing area after the service. And then my final introduction is Lynn White. Lynn served 5-plus years previously and left for a brief period of time, but came back because she couldn't stay away from her calling. Lynn's compassionate demeanor makes her perfect in her role in connecting current members with events such as our summer picnics and gatherings. She is connecting and scheduling classes such as Alpha, new members, and reaching the underserved and new believers in their faith and their next steps. I want to thank this entire team on stage, but also the 100-plus volunteers that serve our congregation with this team. We are so blessed as a church to have each and every one of them. Now, I'm going to hand it over to Lynn White to do some announcements.
Excuse me. Okay. I'm so glad you're here today. If you're newer to Christ Memorial Church or haven't gotten connected yet, would you fill out a connections card? They're in the pew. But if you prefer a face-to-face, I'll be straight out this door after the service, and I'd love to meet you. The Sanctuary Choir will be singing next Sunday, July 28th. If you'd like to join them, simply show up to the choir loft at 8:25 to pick up music for rehearsal beginning at 8:30 a.m. We hope you can join us. DeVries Studio will be here to take free directory photos next Sunday after the service. Your photo will also be available to purchase. Specific information will be coming next week. And for anyone interested in learning more about our mission work in South Africa and the trip coming up in October, there's an informational meeting at the Fireside Cafe following this morning's worship service. And then finally, we have an opportunity to get together on Tuesday, July 30 at 6 p.m. at Holland Park. Whether you are a charter member or today is your first day, we want you here. And so come on over to the park. We'd ask that you sign up at the kiosk so that we know how much space to secure in the park. Bring your family, your own dinner and chair or blanket. We'll meet over by the playground. And after supper, we can stay to enjoy the American Legion band at 7 p.m. Please sign up at the kiosk and get more details. There's more information about all of these events in the bulletin.
I ask all of you to join us in the call to worship. It's a prayer taken from Ephesians 1, 3 through 18. And so let us pray. O glorious God, we give you thanks in your Son, Jesus Christ. You have given us every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms.
You chose us. Before the world was made, you chose us to be your holy people without fault. In your sight.
You have adopted us as your children in Christ. You have set us free by his blood. You have forgiven our sins.
You have made known to us your secret purpose, which is to bring heaven and earth together in unity with Christ.
You have given us your Holy Spirit, the seal and pledge of our inheritance.
All praise and glory be to you, O God, for the richness of your grace, for the splendor of the gifts, and for the wonder of your love.
Let's stand and sing together.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship your holy name.
Sing out the sun.
Sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass.
The King of Glory, who rules the nation.
nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, come on, sing it out. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place. All that you've done for me. Sing worthy. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Yeah. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you that we have an opportunity to be together as a congregation to worship you. And as we worship you, we not only thank you for the grace that was given, but together we recognize our need for it as well. And so as we come in this morning as we are thankful both for the unity that comes in the shared need for grace, but also the love that comes because you gave it, you provided it, and you sent your son to die on the cross so that we may live. And so, God, we pray today that because of our time together, we will live more deeply into what you are calling us to as we give you all the praise and all the honor and all the glory, praying all this in your son's name. Amen. We're so glad you're here at church this morning. As we continue in worship, we'd like to invite the children to come forward. And as the children are making their way forward for the children's message, we'd like to ask you to take some time to greet the people that are around you.
Going to see the dancers together, actually.
Yeah.
Isn't that cool?
I just want to
good morning. Hey, Luke and Eli, do you want to scoot over here? Maybe by Evelyn? Oh, I'm sorry, there's two Lukes today. Isn't that funny? We got another Luke here. All right, friends, You see this in our Worship of Wonder room, but I need some help. Can anyone find the book of Joel in here? Do you want to come look? It's the book of Joel. Think through your books of the Bible. Is it going to be in the Old Testament or New Testament? And I know you know them. I'll give you a hint. It's in this line somewhere. It's not a big one. That's why it's hard to find. Do you want me to grab it for you?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Do you see all these tiny books here? It's part of the tiny books. See how tiny that is? Look how tiny this book is compared to maybe Luke. Oh man, I can't even get these out. John, Acts, look how tiny that is. So it took a long time to find because it was small. You know, the book of Joel is actually only 3 chapters long. It's super short. And these books right here, these red ones, a lot of these are books of minor prophets. Notice how small these other books are here. Just because they're called minor doesn't mean they're less important. Minor just means that they're smaller than the other major prophets like Isaiah here. Isaiah is pretty big. Now, our sermon today is from the book of Joel, and in these small, minor prophet books, there are real stories and good things that are trying to be said to us, but some of these things are kind of strange that we'll hear. For instance, the verse that we're going to hear today is, "I will repay you for the years that the locusts have eaten." Andrew, do you know what locusts are?
Pretty much everything.
Yeah, he said they're bugs that eat pretty much everything. They're kind of nasty, aren't they? Where else in the Bible have we heard of locusts?
Like the plagues.
Yeah, nice job, the plagues on Egypt. Good job. Okay, I want you to close your eyes for a second. And I want you to imagine your favorite meal. You spent your afternoon helping your parents make it, and maybe you even made your favorite dessert with it as well. And then you step away for a second because you got to use the bathroom. When you come back out, you find that your dog ate it, all of it. How would you feel? Sad? Would you feel maybe angry? I bet that's how the Israelites felt when all the locusts ate their crops. But God says, "I will repay you for the time that you lost." That's an interesting thing to say. How can we get time back? Time is something we can't get back. Well, I'm going to let Pastor Stan take it from there because it gets a bit more complicated for us. All right, let's say our children's blessing together.
May the Lord bless you.
May the Lord keep you.
May the Lord give you peace.
Kids, we're going to watch the dancers, so we're going to go sit in the second row here and watch them. You want to follow me?
Okay. In the beginning of June, Christ Memorial's Sacred Dance Team had the opportunity of contributing to the Sparks of Hope fundraiser. This fundraiser helped a family with a young girl battling cancer. We rehearsed a few pieces from the Creation Ballet we presented this past January and created a few new pieces as well, including the piece you will see today. This dance is an excerpt from a future ballet we have called Esther. We do not yet have a date set, but we are so excited to continue to develop this new worshipful ballet for you. The piece you will see today is set at the time right after Esther becomes queen. She is feeling unsure of this new, extremely heavy role, and so she looks to the Lord and her friends to tell her, "You are here." We encourage you to take this message and apply it to your own lives, that God is always with us. His love is steadfast, overflowing, and fills us with a sense of security that we can trust in him in all seasons of our lives.
Let us pray. Oh, Lord, we've been in that place that Esther inhabited so long ago, a place far from home and family and happiness, a place of darkness and shadow, broken dreams and lost battles, a place where we felt far from you. And we didn't know how to get out of that God-forsaken exile, but then we saw an unexpected sign of your love, a seed of grace sprouting up out of that hard place, a reminder of Jesus' surrender for us on the cross. And we fell on our knees and prayed and found that you were there all along, God with us, Jesus, our Savior and Lord, our Redeemer and friend. So, Lord, we pray today for all who can relate to Esther. Wherever we are today in our spiritual and physical lives, help us to turn our eyes upon Jesus and trust you because of his death and resurrection for us. In his name we pray. Amen.
We introduced a song together at church last week, and we're going to play it again this week. What a thing for us to sing together. The chorus goes, I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I'm going to encourage you to sing along again with us this morning as we use this as part of our time together in worship. The words will be on the screen. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. And what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. Oh, I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. At rest, I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps. So this is my story, and this is my song. I'm praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. Oh, I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior. And he heard. opportunity to lead worship for a mission trip that was taking place here in Holland. And the way we ended our worship time when we were singing together was we would just pray out the lyrics. And so we're going to do that together right now. We're going to use those words. We're going to remember that music, the songs we sing are really sung prayers. And so we're going to just use these words. It's going to be our prayer as we prepare to hear what God has to say to us through Pastor Stan this morning and his word. And so let's use these words as our prayer. Sing, I trust in God.
I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
While they're all finding their way back to where they need to go, just one more word before we open God's Word, and that is about September 8. September 8 is going to be a special Sunday here at Christ Memorial. It's going to be Homecoming Sunday. There ought to be something on the screen above me about that, but if there's not, that's okay. Just like your high school and college homecoming, it's a time to welcome back the people that haven't been here for a while. You know, people who've been gone for the summer at a cottage, or people who've been visiting other churches because they were not particularly happy with what might have been happening here. People shut up in nursing homes and their own homes. And people that live next door to you, people you work with that don't have their own church home. We're going to have a very special homecoming service that Sunday morning. And I hope and pray that you will invite all of those people that I just talked about to come. In the evening, there's going to be an area-wide hymn sing, full choir, full orchestra. I hope we see this place full of people singing God's praise the evening of September 8. Enough words. Let's listen to God's word. It is from Joel chapter 2, a little hard to find, as we heard from the children's message. It is the gospel in a minor key. Joel's a minor prophet, of course, and like all the other minor prophets, the gospel he has sounds a little different than the gospel you hear in, say, Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. Same tune, but variations, sometimes odd. And I've asked Alex if he'll help us to feel our way into the gospel in a minor key by playing Amazing Grace in the major key and then in the minor key, and you'll get the idea.
Thank you.
Same tune, but very different. Some odd notes, but still hauntingly lovely, like Joel 2. There are three passages from Joel 2 that I'll read because they set up the major promise that you already heard Rachel refer to. We'll begin with Joel 2, verse 1, where God says, "Blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy hill. Let all who live in the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is close at hand, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and blackness. Like dawn spreading across the mountains, a large and mighty army comes, such as never was of old nor ever will be in the age to come. Before them fire devours, behind them a flame blazes. Behind them the land is like the Garden of Eden, behind them a desert waste. Nothing escapes them. They have the appearance of horses that gallop along like cavalry. With a noise like that of chariots, they leap over the mountains like crackling fire, consuming stubble, like a mighty army drawn up for battle. At the sight of them, nations are in anguish. Every face turns pale." And then down to verse 12, God calls his people to repent. "Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your heart, not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. And he relents from sending calamity." And then over to verse 21, God makes this great promise. "Be not afraid, O land, be glad and rejoice. Surely the Lord has done great things. Be not afraid, O wild animals, for the open pastures are becoming green. The trees are bearing their fruit, the fig tree and the vine yield their riches. Be glad, O people of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the autumn rains in righteousness. He sends you abundant showers, both autumn and spring rains, as before. The threshing floors will be filled with grain. The vats will overflow with new wine." And here's the text. "I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten, the great locust and the young locust, the other locust and the locust swarm, my great army that I sent among you. You will have plenty to eat until you are full. You will praise the name of the Lord your God who has worked wonders for you. Never again will my people be ashamed. Then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and there is no other. Never again will my people be ashamed." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. "I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten." I think that's one of the most comforting and uncomfortable promises in the entire Bible. As gorgeous as a hillside covered with flowering trees in the spring, as gnarly as a wind-blasted old oak on a sand dune in the winter. It's the gospel in a minor key, full of good news, but complicated. You're going to find this sermon to be complicated because I'm going to dig into this complicated passage. "The Lord will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten. My army that I sent among you." What on earth is that about? And what does it have to do with us? Well, it was breaking news on all Israel's media, and it spread like wildfire all over the land. An army was coming. A great army was descending on Israel from the north and the east. It was an army of locusts. You know, those grasshopper-like insects who have an appetite like a turbocharged weed whacker? Every locust can eat its own weight in food every single day. Imagine me eating 193 pounds of food every day. Locusts can do that. "They came," says Joel, calling on his best poetic instincts, "like dawn spreading over the mountains, like a wildfire roaring across a prairie, like cavalry horses thundering into battle. Before the onslaught of that army of locusts, the sky seemed to shimmer, the earth shook, the sun and the moon were darkened. No wonder, says Joel, at the sight of them, every face turned pale with terror. Now, why would bugs cause such terror? Well, because of what they left behind, which was nothing. Fields that were green and verdant, and trees that were hanging with fruit and leaves, became barren and brown and dead. And as a result, all the animals died. There was no forage for them. And as a result, all the people became poor, and they starved, and they died. No wonder Joel 1, verse 12 says, "Surely the people's joy has withered away." That's where this odd text touches our lives first. In those places where our joy has withered, where the joy of life has been eaten away by the forces of evil. Now, I've been a pastor for over half a century, and I can tell you I've seen a lot of withered joy. I can still see my friend, once a successful businessman, beautiful house, multiple cars, happy family, and then his most trusted associate embezzled $500,000. Then his three biggest customers cut their business by a third, and then the recession hit. And he lost his business and his house and his cars, and his children rebelled. And when I sat with him and his wife, I showed them this text, and his wife wept. She said, "That's us. Our joy has withered." But it's not just adults that see their joy withered. I know a little boy who years ago was stung by a bee. He had one of those terrible allergic reactions, you know, an anaphylactic shock. He almost died. And after that, he was terrified of bees. He'd see them coming, and he'd duck. And then he became frightened of everything that was unusual. And he melted down in class all the time because, well, he was just shook. And the other kids didn't want to play with him. His entire first grade year was eaten by the locusts. Maybe you can relate. It's happened in your life. I know that it's happened in the life of this great church. The locusts have eaten way too much. As you watched the liturgical dance, maybe you could relate to Esther. You've been in that place where you didn't want to be, a hard place, and you couldn't get out, and all you could do is fall on your knees and pray. Well, if you can relate to shriveled joy, withered joy, this prophecy of Joel has some wonderful, wonderful news for you. But first, I'm afraid there's a minor key, a discordant note here. The promise is, "I will repay the years the locusts have eaten the army that I sent among you." And you can hear Israel say, "Wait, what? Those locusts came from you, O God, our God? You sent them?" I told you this is a difficult promise, minor key. And with that, we're introduced to the terrible problem we all know too well, the mystery of God's relationship to our suffering. It's the mystery that has made many a believer grow weak in their faith. How in the world can a good God have anything to do with a plague of locusts? But it gets even worse in this passage. In verses 11 and 12, God says to them, the day of the Lord is great. It is dreadful. Who can endure it? Even now, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, weeping, and mourning. Rend your hearts, not your garments. Return to the Lord your God. I can tell you that must have hit Israel like a slap in the face. Joel says these locusts have come from God as a distant early warning of the coming day of the Lord. And Israel said, wonderful, at last the Lord is going to visit this earth and do his work of justice and take care of all these wicked people who've made life miserable for us. We've been victimized, persecuted, tortured, marginalized, and at last we rejoice that God is going to come in the day of the Lord and give them what they deserve. Bring on the day of the Lord. And Joel says to them, not so fast, people of God. You think you're going to enjoy that day because the sinners are going to get theirs. Well, I tell you, not going to be a great day for you unless you repent of your own sin. What a slap in the face. I mean, you've been the victim of this plague of locusts. You've seen the destructive power of evil eat away at the joy of your life. And God says what you need to do is repent. And you say, me? I need to repent? I'm the one devastated by evil. Why should I repent? I'm the victim here, God. Let those other people repent, those really wicked ones, those villains, those monsters. You see how minor, discordant this is. How do we make sense of something this gnarly? This minor key seems to ruin the wonderful promise. Well, we can say two things, both of them hard to hear, but important. We can hear Jesus talk about the mote and the beam. Remember in the Sermon on the Mount? He said, you know, it's really easy to look into your neighbor's eye and see that little bit of dust and pull it out when you've got a log sticking out of your own. Israel could clearly see how wicked their neighbors were, but they were blind to their own sin. And so God says, if you think it's going to be a great day when I come, you need to look in the mirror and see your own sin, pull out that log. That's one thing, the mote and the beam, that helps a little bit. But then the second thing is the book of Job, which teaches us that not all suffering in our lives can be traced to our own sins. That was the case for Israel. What they did brought the locusts. But Jesus said to his disciples, you remember when they said, Lord, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus said, neither. Don't think that you can draw a straight line from what somebody did wrong to what's wrong in their life, because it doesn't work that way. Job is the classic example. Job did nothing wrong. God said he's righteous. God bragged to the devil. And yet Job lost everything. And he didn't deserve it at all. Book of Job makes it very clear that God didn't send that stuff on Job. But he allowed it, which was a mystery to Job and to us. But even when suffering isn't our own fault and we can't figure out why God allowed it, this call to repent is something we need to hear. Why? Well, you know why. I'll just tell you and you'll say, he's right. Because when suffering comes our way, we get bitter. We begin to doubt God's goodness. Our faith grows weak when we wrestle with undeserved suffering. And so the call to repent is a call to come back, to return to God, And if we do that, God has good news for us. Good news beyond our imagining. That's the promise here. The gospel in a minor key, tangled, troublesome, but good news nevertheless. And I tell you, folks, it's great good news. If we come back to God, however far or near we have wandered from Him, He will repay us the years the locusts have eaten. What does that mean? Well, listen to how God puts it to Israel. Verses 19 and 20, I'm sending grain, new wine, and oil, enough to satisfy you fully. Never again will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. I will drive that army of locusts from you. Their stench will go up. God says, I will destroy the locusts. I will replace your resources. I will bring back your crops, and never again will you sink into this low estate. And I read that, and I read it, and I read it, and I said, well, good for Israel. Good for them. But what about me? And what about you? Is this a promise? Is this a promise that God will repay you for everything you've lost in life? Is this a promise that God will give you back all you've lost? Can that be true? Does God promise to make up for our losses, renew our resources, restore the joy of life? Is the good news really that good? Absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, this ancient promise is not just a little footnote tucked away in a little tiny prophecy that's minor. It's a vivid historical example of the great biblical principle of divine retribution. You know, the teaching that God is going to pay it back. When we think of that, we always think of God paying back the wicked for the wickedness they've done. He's going to balance the moral books of the world. Nobody's going to get away with it in the end. We know that teaching very well. And sometimes we rejoice in it because we've been hurt by them. But here in Joel 2, divine retribution means something much, much more. God's justice balances the books. God's mercy freely gives every gift in Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17 puts Joel 2 in classic gospel terms. For these light and momentary afflictions, every time I say those words, I think somebody in the audience is going to get up and punch me in the mouth. You're calling my afflictions light and momentary? For our slight and momentary afflictions are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs our light and momentary afflictions. What a promise. And Paul didn't make that up. He got it from Jesus, who answered his disciples' hard question, Lord, what are we going to get for all we've given up for you? He says, many times more in this life and in the life to come, eternal life. I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten. Earlier, I mentioned Job. He's a classic example of this teaching about the gospel in a minor key. His life was utterly devastated by the locusts of evil, lost his property, lost his family, his 10 kids, his acclaim in the community, the closeness of his relationship with God. And then at the end of Job, he gets it all back. His property and then some. 10 more kids, his reputation, his standing in the community, his His relationship with God grew immensely as he understood at last the majesty and power of God. If you're listening carefully and you're thinking, you're saying to yourself, well, he didn't get those 10 kids back, did he? No. There's some things from the past that won't be repaid now. Not all the years will be repaid now. 10 years of cancer, some of you have wrestled with it, might not be repaid with 10 years of health. That painful divorce you went through may not be repaid with years of marital bliss. That job you lost might not be repaid with an even better one. My father's years of Alzheimer's disease were not repaid with years of clarity. Which is to say that you may not see the complete fulfillment of this promise in this earthly life. But you will see it. Because, of course, this earthly life is not all there is. 2 Corinthians 4 suggested, all of this is preparation for all of that. I love the way C.S. Lewis puts it in The Last Battle. That's the last book in the Chronicles of Narnia. It'd be nice if I could talk, wouldn't it? Chronicles of Narnia. In The Last Battle, the four children who've been the heroes in the book are all killed in a car crash. All four of them are gone. It's a terrible tragedy, but C.S. Lewis writes, that's when they discovered that life was just beginning. I'll quote him. All their life in this world had been only the cover and the title page. Now they were beginning the great story, chapter one of the great story, which no one on earth has ever read, which goes on forever, in which every chapter is better than the one before. Or as Amazing Grace puts it, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing his praise than when it first begun. In eternity, God will repay you the years the locusts have eaten. Now, I hope that you will not dismiss this as, you know, pie in the sky by and by. It's the gospel for here and now in a minor key. God's final word to his suffering people. In fact, it's a central tenet of the faith we profess every time we say the Apostles' Creed. I believe in Jesus Christ who will come again to judge the living and the dead. Sin may abound in this life, but brothers and sisters, grace abounds in the life to come. And those locusts cannot win. Not here, not there, not ever. What do we do with all this gnarly, tangled stuff? Well, the two things we should always do when we hear the gospel, you know what they are, repent and believe. If you see a locust swarm descending on your life, you know it's coming. Or you find yourself sitting in a field that's been eaten bare, refuse to focus on the bad people around you and refuse to turn away from God. Instead, return to God. His call to repent is not a slap in the face. It's God's hand extended in welcome. Come back. Come home. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me, calling, oh, sinner, come home, come home. But we won't do that unless we believe. We have to trust that God's mercy and grace and love will not allow the losses of life to have the last word. The last word, my friends, is Jesus. Jesus died for us, Jesus rose for us, Jesus reigns for us, and Jesus will return for us. And when he does, one of the 10,000 blessings he will bring is this: I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten. Thanks be to God. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we're grateful for the good news, and we confess that sometimes it seems too good to be true, because life gets so messed up and it doesn't seem like justice and mercy show up nearly often enough. So we're thankful this morning for your reminder in this old, difficult text. Help us to remember the simple promise and believe it, that you're not going to let anything get lost, not in the end. You're going to repay it all, and life is going to be better than we could ever imagine. Help us, Lord, to hold on now, because we believe you, for the sake of Jesus. Amen. And now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Amen. You give me a moment to get to the back?